like a special note to Charlie Bolden. You can put, I think, Charlie already on the stage. Charlie, you're one of the most inspiring people, and we're very fortunate to work with you. We wouldn't have such a diverse, vibrant, and professional conference without your inspiration. As you're always saying, it's not the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the dog. And before kicking off the first panel, again, we'd like to thank Gwynne Shotwell, the president of SpaceX, Ellen Stofan, probably the world's most knowledgeable and inspiring spacewoman. And a special acknowledges for Her Excellency, Sarah El Amiri. Her Excellency, for us as Israelis, having your participation in this conference is like a dream come true. As you profoundly pointed out to us last week in a dry run, the peace agreement between our two nations was a beacon of light in a very difficult 2020. We are honored to have you with us, not only as the first speaker from an Arab nation at an Israeli space conference, but as an inspiring engineer and as a leader of one of the most accomplished space programs in the world. Thank you for sharing your knowledge with us. So have a good and fruitful conference. Charlie, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Ron. And all candor, it's not the size of the dog in the fight, but the size of the fight in the dog. That's my dad saying. He was my high school football coach, and it's what guides me through life. And it's great to be here. You know, you've done the introduction, so I'm going to get right to the conversation. I'm going to join you in thanking our incredible panelists. And so a couple of things for the young ladies. And when I say young, I'm young. Okay. And I'm in my 70s. So anybody who's anywhere close to me down is young. So for all the young ladies and young men watching today, you have an opportunity to hear from three of the world's leaders in science, engineering, and because we also brought in the genius Dr. Ellen Stofan from the Smithsonian, you have someone who is an expert in what I call science, technology, engineering, math, plus the arts and design, STEAM plus AD, to also talk to us. So why don't we just get right into it? You know, Sarah, let me start with you. And for the audience, people who are wondering, why am I calling her Sarah? That's because she's a dear friend and she told me to call her Sarah. So that's why I'm calling her Sarah. But we're going to start with you. And from each of the three of you, just very briefly, talk a little bit about the past, your inspiration, your personal influences, and what made you or what directed you to where you are today. Sarah?
For me, first, it's a pleasure to be a participant in this conference and among such great leaders in the space sector. I'm quite honored to share the screen with Charlie, Dr. Ellen, and with Gwynne. What inspired me to where I am today? First off, I never, growing up in the UAE, I've never thought that working in the space sector was possible. We never had a space program. Or a development capability in space until 2006. My one passion in life was to be a computer programmer and to design and develop software with the limited capabilities when it came to that area. I completely fell into the space program in early 2009 by mistake by answering to some anonymous ad for a software engineer. I didn't even know what the company was or what were they meant to be doing. And unbeknownst to me, that was actually the very start of the space program in the Emirates, but was kept quiet and under wraps because we were such a young nation and it was a very challenging feat to undertake. And I was grateful and lucky enough to start working within the Dubai SAT programs, which is a series of Earth observation satellites that were meant to stimulate the development of capabilities of engineers in design and development. Continuing on from there, a lot of what inspired me was for my story not to be a one-off, or for the story, at least for the today, the 200 other people that I work with to be one-off. For engineers to not only be working on the adoption of technology in the Emirates, but also to work in design and development of space systems. And we've continuously pushed the boundaries there, leading up to late 2013, when I first heard of the UAE thinking about going to Mars and starting to join in both science and engineering together for the very first time in the country under one program. That has been, I think, my living, breathing hours for the last 7+ years working on this program. And for me today, what's driving me forward is what started the journey in 2009. And that's the importance of further diversifying our economy, utilizing scientists, engineers, artists that are working on design and development and pushing the bounds of the creative and the engineering and the technology world forward and establishing newer and newer industries within the country. And today it's about establishing a space economy. It's also about advancing a lot of the industries that we have today by the adoption of technology and stimulating growth there. And that's, in a nutshell, what has inspired me for the last few years.
Fantastic. Thanks a lot. You know, Gwynne, you're, I'm going to blame you for making all this stuff possible because you built a doggone rocket that works, and it works really cheap compared to everybody else. So tell me a little bit about what took you to Northwestern, of all places, to make you a cat, and what brought you to today?
Well, I wanted to thank you for inviting me to this panel. It is an honor to be here working with you and the other fine panelists. So thanks very much. And it's also an honor to be part of this conference. It's a special conference. So how I fell into, I fell into space, but I didn't quite fall into engineering. My mom took me to a Society of Women Engineers event when I was a teenager. And I fell in love with the mechanical engineer that was speaking that Saturday morning. And that day I decided to be an engineer. So I would say that I'm an engineer. It was my mother's fault. But as far as space goes, it was a really random situation. I was finishing up my master's degree at Northwestern, and I'll come back to why Northwestern, but I was finishing up my master's degree there, and I ran into a former professor from my undergrad, and he was working out in Los Angeles in the aerospace field, and he said, hey, we're looking for people like you, and you need to apply. And so I applied, I got the job, and I moved out from the Chicago area to Los Angeles, started my space career in 1988, so quite some time ago. As far as Northwestern, this is, I think, is an important story to tell. When I was a young person figuring out where I was going to go to college, I was quite worried at the time, because this was the late 70s, actually. I was quite worried about like being a nerd, not being part of the crowd. And so I really wanted to go to a university that was known for the arts. It was known for the journalism school. I did not want to go to a university that was purely known for technology. I'm hoping people's perspective on that has evolved, although Northwestern's obviously still a great school, both in the arts as well as technology. But I was quite afraid of universities like Massachusetts Institute of Technology. That was a scary place to go for a teenager. So I started my career in aerospace in '88 and have been doing really exciting work ever since.
Fantastic. And finally, Ellen, Dr. Stofan, I brag about Dr. Stofan because she taught me, she's my science teacher. She was my chief scientist when I was at NASA. And I came in as this, you know, just plain old Marine Corps pilot, not knowing a lot. And she became my science teacher. She now runs the Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum and has revolutionized what goes on there. So Ellen, tell us a little bit about how you happened to evolve to where you are today.
Well, Charlie, as you know, I actually grew up at NASA because my dad was a rocket engineer. I grew up going to launches. I went to my first launch when I was 4. Yet at that time, while I loved NASA, I actually didn't think about working there because everybody who worked at NASA looked like my dad. And so as I got older, I got really interested in science and I knew I wanted to be a scientist. But, you know, I would search for books about women scientists. And I'd find books about Marie Curie, and that was pretty much it. But at that time, Mary Leakey was in Africa studying human origins, and it was all over National Geographic. And I realized women can be scientists. They can make huge contributions. So I stuck with it. And when I was 14, the Viking landers landed on Mars. And I went and heard this guy, Carl Sagan, talking about how you could study the planet and understand its geology and its history. and search for life. And I thought, oh, I can combine being a scientist with NASA. This is cool. So that's what I ended up doing. I've been lucky to participate in a ton of NASA missions to Mars, to Venus, staying at home, of course, to the outer solar system, studying the moons of Saturn. But I was really excited to come and work at the Smithsonian's National Air and Space Museum because this issue of whose stories do we tell? Are we telling stories to make sure that every kid sees themselves as someone who can build a new rocket, who can explore a new planet, who can build a more fuel-efficient airplane? And so telling stories of all of our population is really exciting to me. And on top of that, the theme of the conference today, it's really fun at the Air and Space Museum to see how the space sector is changing over time and to talk about that, how everyone can participate, how the whole world, partially because of great companies like SpaceX, lowering the cost of access to space has made it easier for everyone to participate. And when everyone participates, we do more, we go further, we learn more. So it's a really exciting time to be part of the space sector. And I also want to thank the organizers for inviting me to be here today.
Great. Let me jump to the present. You know, if for people who spend their lives on the freeway, like we do around here in the DC area, or Gwynne, when she's back home in LA, hopefully you don't spend a lot of time on the freeway, but there's a freeway between here and Mars. And believe it or not, it's crowded right now. And you may say, how can that be? Well, because there are three different spacecraft from three different nations that are like one right behind the other on the way to Mars. And, so I think out in front, we've got the Emirates Mars mission, the Hope probe. And I'm gonna ask Sarah just to talk very briefly about it here in a second. But right behind that is Tianwen-1, which is the Chinese Mars mission. And I don't think we know a lot about it, except that it's supposed to be an orbiter, or a lander on a rover. And then behind that is Perseverance, carrying something that's never been on the planet Mars before, a helicopter. It's called Ingenuity. And they're going to arrive at Mars February 9th. Is that correct, Sarah? Okay, so that's number one is EMM, February 9th, the next day, Tianwen-1, February 10th, and then several days later, February 18th, Perseverance, and we get to see this crazy kind of landing again. So I'm gonna go backwards. Ellen, what's happening now? What's going on in the world of space exploration today, and what's important about how it affects humanity?
You know, there's so much going on right now, you know, from Perseverance, which we're really excited about because Perseverance is actually going to cache a sample on Mars, pick up a sample, put it in a container for eventual return to Earth. Now, that's really critical because we think that there's a good chance that 3.5 to 4 billion years ago, life could have evolved on the red planet. And just think what an incredible discovery that would be to help us understand what is the possibility of life, not just in our solar system, but that helps us understand the potential for life in outside of our solar system in the universe. So that small discovery on Mars would actually have huge implications. So really excited about Perseverance and what it's going to accomplish. We're finishing up the James Webb Space Telescope that's going to be able to look within a few tens of millions of years of the Big Bang to understand the origins of the universe. It's going to be looking at the atmospheres of planets around other stars, looking for that oxygen, methane, carbon dioxide that could indicate habitability. So on the science front, there's just an incredible amount going on. And of course, the most important thing that I know, Charlie, you and I talk about a lot, is the fact that we have this whole flotilla of spacecraft from countries all around the world that are looking at planet Earth, making sure that we understand the effects of human-induced climate change on the planet, making sure we're making measurements that help agriculture, that help people understand sea level rise, that really help us adapt better and mitigate the effects of climate change while we do something to stop it.
Great. Gwynne, talk to me a little bit about your world. You got this giant, big rocket that everybody's all interested in. And besides that, you're trying to help people in parts of the world that could never talk to the rest of the world before. So you've got these gazillion satellites that are zipping around Earth trying to help people talk to each other. Can you talk about that part of the world today?
Absolutely, Charlie. So outside of the Falcon and the Dragon program, which I find to be incredibly exciting, the new programs that SpaceX is working, the Starlink program, which is a low Earth orbiting satellite constellation for broadband. And low Earth orbit satellites don't differentiate what country you're flying over or what parts of the nations you're flying over. They have the capacity to put beams any place on Earth. We're so excited about this. We've already connected people that have never been connected or have hardly been connected. And so that's a really exciting, really exciting project. So that's the Starlink program. And by the end of the year, we should have full global coverage, and any nation that wants to have this capability should be able to, anybody in the nation on the globe should be able to have that capability. And then there's Starship. Starship is an incredibly exciting program. Elon's running that out of our South Texas facility down in Boca Chica, Texas. What is Starship? Starship is an evolution, a great evolution in rocket technology. Our Falcon program right now, the first stage is reusable. And if you think about human exploration or exploration of space, I think the best way to do that is with humans. Robotics are great, but there's a limitation there. So you can imagine, what would the globe be like now? What would humanity be like now if air travel wasn't what it is today? And what's a key feature of air travel? Air travel, the airplanes are reusable. You don't fly from LA to the UAE and then dump the aircraft, right? The aircraft gets to come back to the back to its home base. So we believe that rocket technology needs to be the same, fully reusable. Falcon has a first stage reusable. Starship has both first stage and second stage reusable. What does that mean? That means that will provide the ability for people to truly explore outer space. In a way that is financially reasonable. And I say reasonable, you said Falcons are cheap. I still think millions of dollars is not really cheap.
Relative. It's a relative term.
You're right, relatively inexpensive. So the Starship program is super exciting. We're doing hops now. We did three hops of the upper stage, which is the Starship vehicle, last year. I believe we'll be getting to orbit this year with the first stage, the Super Heavy booster, as well as Starship on top. That will allow people to go to the moon and back. That will allow people to go to Mars and back and really start the human exploration of our solar system. And my passion is to explore beyond the solar system. I want to find the other people, not in fossils on the surface of Mars or in some sort of residual capability. I want to find the actual living beings that are out in the cosmos.
See, I'm going to bring you back and let you talk to Pete Warden toward the end of the day here. So don't stray too far, but he's going to be talking about that. Sarah, let me come back to you. And, I am pleasantly shocked that you're even able to sit here with us. Your stomach's probably churning and all other kinds of stuff, because I'm not sure people understood when I said you were the deputy project manager for the Hope Probe for the Emirates Mars mission. You know, you're leading the science effort. Why is it important? What's going on? And then another question that I think I understand, because I've been in that, in your part of the world, what outside of science are you trying to do with the Emirates Mars mission?
So first, I'll speak from the global perspective of why the Emirates Mars mission is important. For us, as a first country and a first endeavor of going to planetary exploration, just leaving the confines of the surroundings of Earth was challenging in and onto itself. We've never done it before. And we had a short amount of time from when we started. So late 2013 was when we thought of the program. We started working on it mid-2014. That left us with about 6 years of design, development, testing, and launch so that we can launch by 2020. And what that allowed us to do from an engineering perspective and from a science perspective is change the way the typical approach to planetary exploration happened. And what we did is looked at design and development methodologies, be it at Europe or US, and rethink how we're going to approach the design of our spacecraft, How are we going to reduce the time? How are we going to increase reliability without adding on additional burden? And then the cost was a major factor for us. And it's not cheap. It's hundreds of millions of dollars. It's $200 million, including launch. But relatively speaking, in a larger context of things when compared to other missions to Mars, it is of a lower cost. And we had those constraints in mind. So 6 years, $200 million to launch this spacecraft. Therefore, revisit how you design and develop the spacecraft. And we even revisited how a country can enter into planetary exploration and ensure that its mission is scientifically viable. So our science questions are questions that the science community have asked, that there's no other mission that's providing the necessary data to answer them. And it's been through international collaboration. We collaborated with the University of Colorado Boulder, where our team worked in conjunction with their team on the project as one team, and approached the design and development of the spacecraft. And for once, we amalgamated the science team and engineering team together from day zero on working on designing this mission, and having our systems engineers sit together with the scientists and the instrument scientists to discuss how this mission would evolve. And that allowed us to cut down sort of the mission concept to down to 3 months to just understand what the spacecraft's going to be and what the instruments are going to be there. So this is from the perspective of this mission overall and what it's brought for us in terms of expediting the development of expertise, and also from the international community's perspective with regards to an approach to developing missions for outer space exploration. Now for the region, again, when we started this mission, a lot of the countries in the region have undergone the Arab Spring. A lot of turmoil was happening across the region overall. And a lot of youth were misused by various groups. Rather than have them developing their talents within stable nations to be able to positively contribute to the growth of their nations and regions, they were pulled towards being used by various groups and marginalized within their communities and not provided with the right skills. For us as the Emirates, that is our neighborhood, and that was unacceptable for us to be a neighborhood, especially that we are also a country that is largely made up of people under the age of 35. And this mission was entrusted to a team. We were all under 35. I think at the time of the start, most of us were under 30 when we first started working on the Emirates Mars mission. Our average age even to today is 27. 34% of the team are women, and that's completely based on merit. And that has instigated another dialogue within the region of what's possible. And if you take youth and entrust them with a program that is typically considered challenging, typically considered difficult, half of those missions succeed only, and allow them to develop in the right direction. And on the back of that, we've put together an Arab Pioneers program to train a select few engineers and scientists across the Arab world within one of our space programs. And that will be instigated, has been delayed due to COVID, but instigated hopefully towards the end of this year. That has changed a lot of the dialogue, as we've seen. And in 2020, after the launch, and I think this was alluded to early on, even sort of the framework of the region has changed with the normalization of the relationship with a lot of Arab nations with Israel. And that has, for space especially, and for technology, will open up a regional testbed for testing technologies, for developing startups, for allowing small businesses to grow, and with the cost of space going down, a cost of access to space going down. And more importantly for me, the cost of space going down means more spacecrafts are being launched to space, which means for people that aren't able to build spacecraft, they have more data to play with. And that's where the role of data analytics and extracting value out of space systems comes into play. And that's going to play a vital role in instigating a lot of the space community in the region at a relatively lower cost because of the overall ecosystem. So perhaps, Gwynne, I'd like to thank SpaceX for instigating that to start happening and for creating a new space sector. And that's what a new demand for space, where before it was largely non-existent.
Okay, Gwynne, I see you. Your brow is furrowed as if you have questions to ask. Let me put you in the driver's seat here for a second. Pick one, Ellen or Sarah, and ask a question that's going through your beautiful head there right now.
I would love to ask Sarah, has she seen or could she share a story about a specific example, how the HOPE mission has changed a young person's life in the UAE?
So early on in the mission, around 2014 or 15, we used to hold a lot of workshops with students at university. So we went all the way down to nurseries, 2 and 3 year olds, all the way to university. And at one of the events, we came forward and spoke about the mission. We made a point that a lot of our outreach programs are conducted by team members. So the engineers, the research analysts that were working on the project were the ones that were providing those sessions. In one of them, a student heard what we were doing, and I think he questioned members of the team. So we'd sit with them in small groups. So that happened in the table next to me, and he questioned a member of the team on, so what are you working on? What kind of research do you do? How did you start your field of research and so on? And it was a member of the science team. And a day later, he was a friend of a member of the team. He called and he said, because I've always been passionate about math and physics, but I thought it was an area that I couldn't find a job in the Emirates, unless I wanted to become an educator, and I don't want to become an educator. And so he was a freshman studying international studies. And after that workshop, he went and changed his major from international studies to mathematics with a minor in physics. And that for me was a moment of, it's just one person, one story, but a moment of realization that someone studied something completely, perhaps he was passionate about it, but he was much more passionate about another area of work and thought that it was something that he cannot possibly work in. And that's one of the examples that we've had. I've also had another example of a mother calling up out of frustration. I don't know how I happened to call on my desk. We were running a space camp for students who were, I think, 11 to 15 years old. She was trying to get her son into the program. Perhaps I think the time went off, and she just called and she said, my son is talking about space. I really don't understand what he's saying. Can you guys please take him and support him in this? I really don't know how to support him. And for me, that was a momentary pause, because when I spoke about space at his age, I was called crazy for thinking that our country is going to have a space program. And today I'm hearing a mother saying that I don't know what he's talking about, but can you please support me in ensuring that he's down the right path and has the right guidance and is provided with the right information? And can you help me in responding to him? Because I don't understand what he's saying. And those for me were two stories that struck a chord for me on the importance of what we're doing, and has been a driving passion of what I've been doing for the last few years.
Ellen, Sarah's just got me excited about what you're doing, what you're trying.
If I can add, you know, I've actually seen the effects in the UAE itself, because a couple years ago I was over there speaking at universities, and I was speaking to a lot of the engineering classes. And going into the engineering classes in the UAE, over half the students are women. And so I don't wanna, Sarah would never say this, but just the fact she's in that position and is in such a leadership position, she is actually inspiring women in the UAE to say, I can be an engineer, I can participate. So having role models like Sarah, like Gwynne, I think is incredibly important to this next generation of engineers, innovators, and entrepreneurs.
Yeah, Sara and I have this discussion now and then, and she always shies away from it. You know, Sara, what's the percentage of women in the science team?
The Emirati women in the science team is 80%, and we went down from
100%. Say that again.
80%, and we went down from 100%. I had to diversify the other way.
Say that one more time for me.
So science team on the Emirates Mars mission is 80% women.
And your problem is one of diversity. Is that not correct?
Yes, it is.
Because you're concerned, but we have this discussion and I cry. Because if I had that problem, if Ellen and I had that problem when we were at NASA, we would have jumped up and down and screamed. And hopefully everybody understands, you know, what the message I get from her is that it's critically important that she get participation from the men in that community. Otherwise, the alternative for them is not very good. Ellen, talk a little bit about the changes you're trying to make at the Smithsonian to do what Sarah is doing in the UAE. You know, you're walking distance from Anacostia. For people who don't know Washington, D.C., you cross the Anacostia River, and it's like, I mean, it's dramatically different from when I was growing up, but it is still different from the rest of Washington, D.C., and you brought me to tears with your first commercial. So I told you could not show it in this forum, but talk a little bit about the approach you're taking to making the Smithsonian. Gwynne's trying to make space flights, access to space, affordable for people. Sada's doing something similar in her community. What are you doing in the nation, the world actually, because the Smithsonian is the world's museum. What are you doing there to try to make it available to everybody?
Well, I think the most important thing, and this is a point I hope is not lost on anyone with those statistics of Sarah's, you know, 80% women, you know, most science teams in the United States are 80 to 90% men. And I grew up in an era where people said, well, that's just because men are good at it and women aren't. And what you're seeing is a cultural thing, right? It's not an ability thing. And so if you expand that out and you say, all right, if everyone looks the same on our teams, we know from research, we're not performing as well. We're not being as innovative. We're not being as creative. So it's important, no matter what, that we need diverse teams. We need our teams to look like our populations. And so in the United States, it's really critical to me to say, how do we reach out to all kids to say, space is inspiring, space is for innovators, space is for entrepreneurs. And it doesn't matter if you like agriculture or art or engineering, there's a place for you in helping explore and move humans beyond Earth out into the solar system. So we're really thinking, as I said earlier, about whose stories we tell. Are we talking about Charlie Bolden? Are we talking about Margaret Hamilton? Are we talking about Katherine Johnson? Are we making sure we're talking about all the women and men of all color who've helped move our space program forward to make sure that every kid can see themselves as someone who can succeed? The other thing I'm trying to do is to say, you know, museums just aren't about the past. Museums are about the future. So one of the galleries I'm really excited about as we renovate the Air and Space Museum in Washington is going to be about the future of spaceflight. And it's going to be talking about companies like SpaceX and Virgin Orbit and Blue Origin that are really helping change how we explore space. It's going to be about countries like the UAE saying, look, now we have a much broader range of international participation. And it's about saying, you know, you can literally, as a high school student, build a CubeSat, you know, send an experiment up to the International Space Station. Space is for everyone. It really is the new frontier. And everyone can join in and participate. And as we've said over and over again, when everyone can participate, no matter what you look like, no matter what country you're from, we're going to get more science, we're going to understand our data better, and we're really going to help move this world forward in such a positive way.
You know, we've got some questions that are kind of queued up. Melody back there in the back room, if you can, I want you to just roll them. There are three questions that we'll start with that were pre-recorded. I apologize, but they struck me as really nice. So Melody, if you want to run the first question, we'll throw it out there and see what we get.
Hey, my name is Noah Lubin. I'm a data scientist working at Diagnostic Robotics. And my question is for Ellen. As former NASA chief scientist and current head of Biden's NASA transition team, I wanted to ask you, how do you see our role as entrepreneurs from a small nation in a large space industry? And how do we fit in large NASA projects such as Artemis?
This is a young student, and I really want, she has a phenomenal question. You think we can re-roll it with the volume or go to the next question, maybe, if that one's working? and then we'll come back? What do you think, Ron?
Hi, my name is Raz. I am the CEO of NSLCOM, an Israeli space startup. We manufacture expendable antennas for satellites, so they can transmit and receive between 10 to 50 times faster and higher throughput than same size satellites. I have two questions for Gwynne Shotwell. The first is, does SpaceX perform scouting for technologies that can augment their communication, their satellites' communication capabilities? And the second is whether SpaceX intends to open research and manufacturing facilities all over the world, like other corporates such as Microsoft and Google. Thank you.
Yes, those are...
Everyone, my name is Adan from the Space Lab program at the Ramon Foundation. My question is for Sara Bint Yousef Amiri. We're really excited that you all came to talk to us today. Thank you for the Ramon Foundation for making this happen. نحن مسرورون جدا لوجودك معنا اليوم ونشكر جمعية رامون للقيام بهذا الشيء. I'm thinking about a career in the space industry. What is the most significant decision that you have made during your career?
Sounds great, Charlie. So the first question was, does SpaceX look outside the company for technologies? We're definitely known to be a vertically integrated company, meaning we build quite a bit of our technologies in-house. We do the integration and we do the operation. But that's not to say that we don't look outside of SpaceX for great technology and capability. What we do is we do a make-buy trade with any key piece of hardware or technology. If it's not strategically important to the company, we are happy to purchase outside. We need to make sure that it's the right price, high quality, and quick, because we spin our designs for the Falcon rocket, the Dragon, Starship and Starlink. We spin those system designs so frequently. Many times it's hard for external organizations and subcontractors to work with us on those very quick timelines. But we certainly do. We do not build the entire rocket. We do not build every element of Dragon. We just build a lot of them. And then the second question is, will we look internationally to open up capabilities, whether it's hardware, software development, or research? With the advent of the Starlink program, which is a satellite program, a communication satellite program, that really opens up our ability to do things internationally. Rocket technology, our State Department, the US State Department, keeps very tight control on rocket technology. So it's very difficult for us to look overseas for support or establish capability overseas. But Starlink and the telecom industry does allow that more. And so I think you'll probably see more international partnerships there.
Great. Melody, can we go back to either of the two student questions and rerun it?
Hey, my name is Noah Lubin. I'm a data scientist working at Diagnostic Robotics. And my question is for Ellen. As former NASA chief scientist and current head of Biden's NASA transition team, I wanted to ask you, how do you see our role as entrepreneurs from a small nation in a large space industry? And how do we fit in large NASA projects such as Artemis?
Well, I think there's a lot of opportunity in that space. It's a great question. And I think, you know, being a data analyst, you're really right in the right field because, you know, as I was mentioning earlier, one of the biggest areas to me of growth that we're going to see over the next 10 years is really in data analytics, especially around Earth observation data. So whether it's how we do better at predicting weather in an increasingly chaotic weather systems because of the effect of a warming climate, whether it's really trying to understand the effects of climate change on food, on water availability around the world, we're collecting huge amounts of data about this planet and trying to turn that, those huge amounts of data into actionable information that helps people all around the world live in this changing climate is something that, that is really critical. And we need all hands on deck. We need people from all around the world to be utilizing this data. And it always makes me really happy that NASA data, Earth observation data, is available to the public for no cost. So that's one area. When you think about Artemis and exploring out beyond the Earth, whether it's the research, the opportunity you're having soon to do experiments on the International Space Station, think of the International Space Station as the test bed for moving humans out beyond Earth. What kind of food are our astronauts going to eat? How do we get them clean water and breathable air? How do we get the technologies we need for long duration stays on either the surface of the moon or the surface of Mars? We need everybody around the globe participating and thinking about how to solve these really tough problems. So whether it's an experiment on the ISS, or it's really walking through how you do operations remotely, there's really opportunities for everyone. And I think it's really an exciting time.
Great. I guess Ron and Melody, I was asking the question, do we have a way to cue back to the very first question, or should I press? I see you shaking your head. Does that mean press?
Ron, my name is Adan from the Space Lab program at the Ramon Foundation. My question is for Sara Bint Yousef Amiri. We're really excited that you all came to talk to us today. Thank you for the Ramon Foundation for making this happen. نحن مسرورون جدا لوجودك معنا اليوم ونشكر جمعية رامون للقيام بهذا الشيء. I'm thinking about a career in the space industry. What is the most significant decision that you have made during your career?
So the most important decision that I've made during my career was to not say no to a challenge because I did not have the full knowledge to complete a role. And that has happened early on. That also happened, that was maybe the reason why I started with the Emirates Mars mission. We did not have a science team at the time. I had been in engineering by education, by training up to that point. But somebody had to start a science team and ensure that there's an integration of science capability development within this mission so that we can start a space science department within the Space Center. And I did not say no to that opportunity, and it has been one of the most challenging roles on understanding, and I think Ellen would know this, understanding how to work with scientists. People think scientists and engineers are the same. We're not, we work great together at times, but we think differently, and we approach problems differently, and we approach solutions differently, and that has been one of the biggest challenges in my career so far, but has been the most rewarding, personally, and with regards to the program. So not saying no to a challenge because I'm not well versed in it.
Fantastic. You know, I want to sit here and talk for the rest of the day, except Melody will kill me. So I'm gonna move us toward closure here, if you will. Very briefly, and let me start with you, Gwynne. Give me your perspective on where we're gonna be around the world in terms of space exploration and utilization. Let's say the next 10 to 50 years.
So I strongly believe that in the next 10 years, we will see people starting to settle on another planet or another heavenly body, whether
it's 10 years
or Mars. Yes, 10 years.
Okay.
Yes. You said 10 to 50.
I
think it's 10 years.
No, I'm not questioning it. I just wanted to make sure I heard it right because yes. People tell me I'm crazy when I say this.
People tell us we're crazy every day. You have to ignore that and push forward. And what I really hope will occur is that we will find a breakthrough in propulsion technology that will allow us to go beyond the moon, beyond Mars, and even beyond the solar system to explore the cosmos. And I think that will happen. I don't think that's gonna happen in 10 years. I don't think we're gonna hit pay dirt there, but I think certainly within 50 years, we will have a path to propulsion technology that will allow us to fly to really to other worlds.
Great. Ellen, your perspective?
I'm right there with Gwen. You know, I think our biggest opportunities lay ahead of us, whether it's finding life, ancient life remnants on Mars, having humans walk and explore the surface of Mars, really understanding our cosmos. I think there's just incredible opportunity. And again, the most exciting thing to me is this isn't 50 years ago where it's just a few big countries participating. There's room for everybody. There's room for countries all around the world. And there's room for all of us, no matter what we look like, to be part of this great adventure.
Sarah.
So I'd second that with regards to exploration, but we would probably see more and more of the private sector involved in exploration, pushing the boundaries forward there. And from what Ellen spoke about early on, with the advent of the utilization of Earth observation data, we would probably have a better understanding of our planet and a better utilization of space assets. And the creation of further new companies, especially within my region, in the space sector.
Phenomenal, phenomenal, phenomenal. So I'm going to close us out with a quote from the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. He, some of you, especially here in the United States, you know that last week we celebrated his birthday, and everybody on the world stage saw what happened here in my now almost hometown of Washington, D.C., that no one ever expected to see from the United States. So we got a lot of work to do here, but I think Dr. King speaks very, very appropriately to what we're talking about today. No one would connect him with science, but I always have. So here it is. Yet in spite of these spectacular strides in science and technology, and still unlimited ones to come, something basic is missing. There is sort of poverty of the spirit, which stands in glaring contrast to our scientific and technological abundance. The richer we have become materially, the poorer we have become morally and spiritually. We've learned to fly the air like birds and swim the sea like fish, but we have not learned the simple art of living together as brothers. We have amazing knowledge of vitamins, nutrition, the chemistry of food, and the versatility of atoms. There is no deficit in human resources. The deficit is in human will. That was an excerpt from his acceptance speech of the Nobel Peace Prize, December 10th, 1964. So I will close with that and thank Ron and Melody and everybody in the Ramon Foundation. Che Bolden, who I work for, my son, I cannot thank you all enough, but most especially Ellen, Gwynne, Sara, you have made this last almost hour just incredible for all of us who had an opportunity to listen to you. So, shalom.